Henry and Gordon were lonely when Thomas left the yard to run his branch line. They missed him very much. They had more work to do and had to fetch their own coaches. The big engines thought they were too important to fetch coaches. James grumbled too. "We get no rest, we get no rest," they all complained. But the coaches only laughed. "You're lazy and slack, you're lazy and slack," they answered. Altogether, the engines were causing Sir Topham Hatt a great deal of trouble. The big stations at both ends of the line each have a turntable. Sir Topham Hatt had made them so that the tender engines can be turned around because it is dangerous for them to go fast backwards. Little tank engines like Thomas don't need turntables. They can go just as well backwards as forwards. But to hear Gordon talk, you would have thought that Sir Topham Hatt had given him a tender just to show how important he was. "You don't understand, little Thomas. We tender engines have a position to keep up. It doesn't matter where you go, but we are important. And for Sir Topham Hatt to make us do shunting, fetch coaches, and go on some of those dirty sidings, it's not the proper thing." Thomas chuckled and went off with Annie and Clarabel. "Disgraceful," Gordon hissed as he ran backwards to the turntable. The turntable was in a windy place close to the sea, and if he was not on it just right, he put it out of balance and made it difficult to turn. Today, Gordon was in a bad temper, and the wind was blowing fiercely. His driver tried to make him stop in the right place, but Gordon wasn't trying. The fireman tried to turn the handle, but Gordon's weight and the strong wind prevented him. "It's no good," they said at last. "Your big tender upsets the balance. If you were a little tank engine, you'd be all right. Now you'll have to pull the next train backwards."
"Look," called some boys. "There's a new tank engine." "Oh, it's only Gordon back to front." "Hello," called Thomas. "Playing tank engines? Sensible engine. Take my advice. Scrap your tender and have a nice bunker." Gordon said nothing. Even James laughed when he saw him.
"Take care," hissed Gordon. "You might stick too." "No fear," chuckled James. "I'm not so fat as you."
"I mustn't stick," thought James. He stopped on just the right place to balance the table. It could now swing easily. Gordon arrived in time to see everything. James turned much too easily. The wind puffed him round like a top. He couldn't stop.
"Well, well," said Gordon, "are you playing roundabouts?"
Poor James, feeling quite giddy, rolled off to the shed without a word. That night, the three engines had an indignation meeting. "It's shameful to treat tender engines like this. Gordon has to go backwards and people think he's a tank engine. James spins round like a top and everyone laughs at us.
And to add to that, Sir Topham Hatt makes us all shunt in dirty sidings. Blech!"
"Listen," said Gordon. He whispered something to the others. "We'll do it tomorrow. Sir Topham Hatt will look silly." The engines had decided to go on strike.
Sir Topham Hatt sat in his office listening to the noise outside. The passengers were angry.
A station master came in. "There's trouble in the shed, sir. Henry is sulking, there's no train, and the passengers are saying this is a bad railway."
"Indeed," said Sir Topham Hatt. "We cannot allow that."
He found Gordon, James, and Henry looking very cross. Come along, Henry. It's time your train was ready. Henry's not going, said Gordon.
We won't shunt like little tank engines. That was Thomas's job. We are important tender engines. You fetch our coaches and we will pull them. Tender engines don't shunt.
We'll see about that, said Sir Topham Hatt. No engine on my railway is too important for small jobs. And he hurried away to find Edward.
The yard has never been the same since Thomas left to run his branch line, he thought sadly. Edward was shunting.
Leave those freight cars, please, Edward, said Sir Topham Hatt. I want you to push coaches for me in the yard.
Thank you, sir. That will be a nice change. That's a good engine. Off you go, then.
So Edward found coaches for the three engines, and that day the trains ran as usual. Next morning, Edward looked unhappy. Gordon came clanking past, hissing rudely.
Bless me, said Sir Topham Hatt. What a noise!
They all hiss me, sir, answered Edward.
They say tender engines don't shunt, and last night they said I have grey wheels. I haven't, have I, sir?
No, Edward, you have nice blue ones, and I'm proud of you. Tender engines do shunt. But all the same, we do need another tank engine here.
He went to a workshop and they showed him all sorts of engines. At last he saw a smart little green engine with four wheels. That's the one, he thought. If I choose you, will you work hard? Oh, sir, yes, sir. That's a good engine. I'll call you Percy.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir, said Percy. And Sir Topham Hatt brought him back to the yard.
Edward, he called. Here's Percy. Will you show him everything? Percy soon learned what he had to do, and they had a happy afternoon. Then Henry came by, hissing as usual. When Percy,
Henry jumped and ran back to the shed.
How beautifully you weeshed him, laughed Edward. I can't weesh like that.
Oh, said Percy, that's nothing. You should hear them in the workshop. You have to weesh loudly to make yourself heard.
Next morning, Thomas arrived.
Sir Topham Hatt sent for me. I expect he wants help, he said to Edward.
Shh, shh.
Here he comes, replied Edward.
Well done, Thomas. You've been quick. Listen, Henry, Gordon and James are sulking.
They say they won't shunt like little tank engines. So I have shut them up and I want you both to run the line for a while.
Little tank engines indeed, snorted Thomas. We'll show them.
And Percy will help too.
Oh, sir, yes, sir, please, sir, answered Percy.
Edward and Thomas worked the main line, greeting each other as they passed by. Percy puffed along the branch line.
Thomas was anxious about Annie and Claribel, but both driver and conductor promised to take care of them.
There were fewer trains, but the passengers didn't mind. They knew the three other engines were having a lesson. Gordon, James, and Henry were cold, lonely, and miserable. They wished now they hadn't been so silly.
Henry, James, and Gordon were miserable. They had been shut up for several days for being naughty and longed to be let out again.
At last Sir Topham Hatt arrived. I hope you are sorry, he said, and understand that every job on the railway is important. We have a new tank engine called Percy, who helps pull coaches, and Thomas and Edward have worked the main line nicely. But I will let you out now if you promise to work hard.
Yes, sir, said the three engines, we will.
That's right, but please remember that this no-shunting nonsense must stop. He then told Percy, Edward and Thomas that they could go and play on the branch line for a few days. And they ran off happily to find Annie and Claribel at the junction. The two coaches were so pleased to see Thomas again.
Edward and Percy played with freight cars. Stop, 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 screamed the cars as they were pushed into their proper sidings. But the two engines laughed and went on shunting till the cars were tidily arranged. Next, Edward took some empty cars to the quarry.
Percy was left alone. He didn't mind that a bit. He liked watching trains and being cheeky to the other engines. Hurry, 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 he would call, and they got very cross.
After a great deal of shunting, Percy was waiting for the signalman to set the switch so that he could get back to the yard. He was eager to work, but was being rather careless and not paying attention.
Edward had warned Percy, be careful on the main line. Whistle to the signalman, you are there. But Percy didn't remember to whistle, so the busy signalman forgot him. Percy waited and waited.
The switch was still against him, so he couldn't move. Then he looked along the main line.
Peep, peep! He whistled in horror, for rushing straight towards him was Gordon with the express. My way! Percy opened his eyes. Gordon had stopped with Percy's buffers a few inches from his own. But Percy had begun to move. I won't stay here. I'll run away, he puffed. He went straight through Edward's station and was so frightened that he ran right up Gordon's hill without stopping. After that, he was tired, but he couldn't stop. He had no driver to shut off steam and apply the brakes. I want to stop. I want to stop, he puffed. The man in the signal box saw Percy was in trouble, so he kindly set the switch. Percy puffed wearily onto a nice empty siding, ending in a big bank of earth. He was too tired now to care where he went. I want to stop. I want to stop. I have stopped, he puffed thankfully. Never mind, Percy, said the workman as they dug him out. You shall have a drink and some coal and then you'll feel better.
Presently, Gordon arrived. Well done, Percy. You started so quickly that you stopped a nasty accident. I'm sorry I was cheeky, said Percy. You were clever to stop. Then Gordon helped pull Percy out from the bank. The two engines are now good friends, but Percy is always most careful when he goes on the main line.